San Giorgio is a fairly nondescript village that sleeps upon a mountainside in Calabria. That remotest province of Italy's Mezzogiorno, Italy's deep south. In 1975, Ralph Glasser, an economist and psychologist by training, now an advisor on development and a writer, came here seeking, as he puts it, the answers to some central human questions.
I came to San Giorgio for a very definite, very important reason. See, I've been involved in development in various countries for 15 years, and as a result, I've become extremely unhappy about its destructive effects. You see, what we've been doing, all of us, is to impose upon people a series of very violent emotional changes as the price of achieving industrialization and technological change. And this realization is such an emotional shock to them that you get a violent explosion in that society, which leads to misery and cruelty and all those other things, which we now see in Iran and in Kampuchea. So what I wanted to do was to find a community where the values of the 19th century and its optimistic belief in the importance of the pursuit of progress as the answer to all the ills of life was still strong. And also a community which was still socially supportive and solid. And I found that in San Giorgio Albanese.
San Giorgio Albanese qualified as Ralph Glasser's time capsule. Not only because it was remote, it is a community of Italo-Albanese, people descended from Albanians who fled here 500 years ago when the Turks conquered their land. Although most of them speak Italian, their mother tongue is still Albanian, Arbëresh as they call it, and they worship according to the Greek Orthodox rite, though under the discipline of Rome. Today, this tight-knit community is disintegrating. How and why this is happening is described by Ralph Glasser through some of the people he came to know here. People like Vittorino Cerrioni. Nowadays, people are ashamed to call themselves contadini, peasants, Vittorino Cerrigoni says. They want to be better off, dress smartly, have a big car, enjoy themselves. Since Vittorino can remember, people have been leaving San Giorgio. They used to emigrate to the United States, to Brazil, to Argentina. Now most of these emigranti go to northern Italy, to Switzerland and Germany. But they also used to come back, with money saved, to resume their position in the village. Now they settle in these far-off places permanently. Few, very few indeed, return to Italy, a convent school that takes girls up to their university entrance. Sister Gabriella is one of the nuns who teaches there. She has known San Giorgio since she was a child. I remember, she says, when you couldn't even say good morning to a boy without exciting gossip. And that's something I've never been able to accept. By nature, I suppose I'm an extrovert. I love people. That's why I'm a nun, to make of that love a vocation. A regular sight in the piazza these days is a new Ford Fiesta. Its proud owner is Padre Vittorio, a local priest. I feel my main concern here, he says, is for the young, for those who hang around the piazza waiting for tomorrow. Traditionally, the San Giorgesi, like most southern Italians, feel no sense of obligation or loyalty to some vague concept of national state. Their loyalty is to their family, and when the family ties are loosened, there's little left to hold them to this place. Last year, says Padre Vittorio, I officiated at 10 marriages. Today, not one of these young couples lives in San Giorgio. They've all left. Vincenzo Minici is a local mayor and a communist. With him and Padre Vittorio, the arrangement is accommodating. Very Italian. After the war, says the mayor, between the church and Italy's Communist Party, there was little compromise, only confrontation. But since Pope John, we have learned to have a reciprocal respect for the good aspects of each other's work. He sums up San Giorgio in a characteristically blunt way. Our main industry, he says, is pensions. Our main employer, the national insurance. The PCI, Italy's Communist Party, holds 12 of the 15 seats in the local council. That has been the pattern since 1948. Up to the war, there was Mussolini. In those days, Giovanni Del Vecchio was a prominent local blackshirt. Nowadays, he votes Christian Democrat. Mussolini, he says, wanted to make Italy great. So great that he nearly destroyed it. Even so, he did get some things done. So here it is, San Giorgio. In no way exceptional. Indeed, perhaps a rather predictable southern Italian village. A village into which there came an inquiring Scot, asking many questions. Ralph Glasser.
When I came in, I think that there was a great deal of suspicion. There were many theories. I might have been a government spy. But then, of course, it was obviously ridiculous that a man from Scotland should be sent by the Italian government to spy on the people of San Giorgio, and they rapidly dismissed that one. But there were many theories, including one that I was a CIA agent, quite seriously considered by some of the people. But after a while, they began to get used to the fact that I was a little naive as far as their view was concerned, that I was fairly harmless, and in the end they came to the conclusion that I really was a well-intentioned fellow whom they could trust.
One of the first things Ralph Glasser wanted to know was how the extraordinary improvements in educational opportunities had affected San Giorgio. Overlooking the village is the convent school, the Istituto Magistrale, where on this particular morning, Sister Gabriella is invigilating end-of-term exams.
Ragazze, tra un minuto si finisce.
In the early 60s, the Italian government raised the school leaving age to 16 and made it easy for nearly everyone to proceed to the state universities. Today, of Italy's 2 million unemployed, half have a university or similar qualification. There are also 2 million job vacancies, but they are not the sort of jobs that these girls' parents hope for as a reward for their sacrificio, the sacrifice they made to get them a good education. Ralph Glasser.
As far as St. George is concerned, it is even more tragic, because the young realize that by sending them in for higher education, the parents have already made a choice on their behalf to send them away. Simply because there is no chance whatsoever for you to get a job as an engineer, a doctor, an accountant, a lawyer, and so on, in a tiny place like this. So by the very fact of education, they are being made into exiles from fairly early childhood. But there is one more factor, and that is the question of status. Historically, the possession of education meant that you had a higher status, and it is translated in a kind of emotional sense into the possession of clean hands. You do not dirty your hands if you're an educated person.
In the village's excellent school, there is a midwife and a doctor. For many of the contadini, cars have replaced donkeys, and most people have the new luxury of television. Last year, San Giorgio even set up its own radio station. But with these material gains, is something being lost? Is it, as Ralph Glasser says, like Peer Gynt's onion? Each encroachment, each plausible change takes something away from the whole. When you peel the culture bit by bit, nothing vital seems to be taken away, yet you reach a point where you see that the heart has disappeared. In San Giorgio, It is happening. And what we see left today is only the remnants. Of course, the old San Giorgio had its share of the tensions and jealousies, some long-standing, that beset small enclosed communities everywhere.
Though it's a closed community, it is not a close one. When they meet in the piazza and shake hands and say, how are you and what is going on, there is also a certain amount of standing back from each other. One thing that's very important to realize is that these people are tremendously independent, and they do to some extent keep each other at arm's length, and yet there is a balance between the necessary independence of the individual and their interdependence. One has to understand that it is a constant equipoise of relationships.
This interdependency Ralph Glasser calls the net, in which each person knows what is expected of him in a never-ending reckoning of obligations and demands. There is still no supermarket in San Giorgio. Every day is market day, when people meet, gossip, quietly measure their place, their standing within the paese. But the young people's allegiance to the old relationships is going, and the reasons are many. Economic uplift, and certainly the desire for it, is a strong one. The second-hand clothes stall in the piazza mainly attracts the older people. The young go to where they sell new shirts and jeans, imported Wranglers and Levi's. But the young don't have jobs, most of them. It isn't easy to measure your manhood according to the old pattern of struggle and sacrifice if you're trying to reject it, and yet have no secure place, no identity in a new one. In this existential confusion, with old certainties fading, things happen that would have been unthinkable only a few years ago. A while back, Angelo Caravetta's chemist shop was broken into and a quantity of drugs stolen.
They regard the old traditions, the integrated, the holistic way of life, as I call it, as being expendable, of no importance. And it's their choice. But if you ask me which do I think is better, then I must say that a harmonious compromise between the old values and the new technology seems to me to be the sensible thing to do. It seems to me not sensible to throw away what you have evolved over centuries, but one would say alienation is the correct word for it. Luna,
Donna Luna, too. But if they want to make a future for themselves in San Giorgio, they have a problem. A problem that Padre Vittorio sees when he visits the local farmers.
Hey, padre, buongiorno.
That problem is simple. The mountainous terrain of San Giorgio doesn't lend itself to conventional mechanized agriculture. Such activity is concentrated now down on the Siboris Plain, where the land is flat and more amenable.
Rendeva molto di più prima. Prima adesso tutte sostanze chimiche, questi trattori, mezzi agricoli, cose, prima le rendeva di più.
E chissà perché?
Ecco perché. Perché se lavorava con la mano dell'uomo. E dopo passa la mano dell'uomo, non c'è nessuna macchina che la può superare. Mm.
Perché c'era un'affezione, terra, la terra era pure affezionata all'uomo.
Come no, come perché gli mando la carizza una roba. Per esempio, se io l'avessi accarezzato se fiore, non c'erano così.
Sì, lo so.
Qua quello che manca più di tutto è l'acqua. Se noi avessimo acqua, queste terre prendevano oro.
Water, certainly, but also the ability to adapt, to concentrate on production more appropriate to this area. For example, forest products and certain specialist crops. But in San Giorgio, old ways die hard and innovation is suspect. Above all, it is something that is expected to come from outside. They wait, as in the past, for them. The bureaucrats in Rome or the industrialists in Turin or Milan to do something. Mezzogiorno means midday. That time when the world stands still and life is suspended behind closed shutters. Waiting for someone else to do something is still the accepted posture in this bleached and most southern land. Siesta is over and the village comes to life again. Giorgio Cerigoni, who set up Radio Delta, San Giorgio's own radio station, is recording traditional Albanese songs. He says, soon there'll be no one left to sing them. I know we play mainly pop music on Radio Delta, but don't let that give you the wrong impression. A lot of the young people are still interested in the old customs and culture. Angela of University in Naples, Giorgetta of simply going anywhere her considerable talent will take her.
Buono e vivificante tuo spirito, ora e sempre nei secoli dei secoli. Amen.
Benedetto. Meanwhile, others return from afar, but usually only for a holiday or a wedding, a funeral, a christening. There are many people who, like Ralph Glasser, want San Giorgio to be a place you stay and make your life in. Not one you return to only occasionally, and even then simply for a brief sojourn.
La serva di Dio Maria viene battezzata nel nome del Padre.
Va bene, ma non è questo, cioè il problema.
Sì, il problema chiaramente non è questo. Però...
In the municipal office, the municipio, the mayor, Signor Minishi, is discussing with an architect and other advisor some rehabilitation plans they have in mind for San Giorgio.
Chiaramente dice, io questo orticello c'ho, se voi me lo espropriate tutto,
se spostandoli un po' più.
Amongst other things, there is great talk of tourism. Already one bold man has opened a trattoria, the first ever in San Giorgio. And up above on the mountain, about a mile away, a building contractor is investing in a hotel, a swimming pool and a disco. San Giorgio, they are saying, could be a new mountain resort. And why not if it brings in money and creates more jobs?
When it happens, the traditions and the way of life of the people concerned become converted into commercial products. And their life itself becomes a piece of theatre which you sell to attract the visitors and to make them come again. And this conversion of your own life into something which you only preserve in order to sell is a kind of diminution of your own valuation of yourself. tourism, though in the short term it's profitable, is a kiss of death to any culture.
What particularly worries Ralph Glasser is that tourism, as experience all over the world has demonstrated, serves to undermine that tight, mutually supportive set of relationships that he calls the net. But something else is also lost. The San Giorgesi call it fiducia.
Literally, of course, the word is very, very misleading because it means faith or trust. But in terms of the interrelationships of people with each other and with the outside world, it means something much more profound. It means a confidence in relationships. I think that is the best way of describing it. Without fiducia, you can't have relationships.
A practical example of the failure of this confidence in relationships is the municipal olive press, the Frantoio Sociale, as it is called. It was designed to oust the five private owners of oil presses from their traditional dominance. Built with public funds, it was to be run as a cooperative. It would accept the peasants' olive harvest, process it into olive oil, and sell it on their behalf. But the people didn't take kindly to the idea of a cooperative, and for some 7 years now, the press has stood idle. Signor Del Vecchio, a farmer himself, states his own reasons for this failure. Of course the peasants prefer to take their olives to the private oil presses for two very simple reasons. The private press owner pays cash in the nail, and secondly has no expensive bureaucrats to pay, so he can give the grower a better price. But Signor Del Vecchio is not exactly impartial. He's one of the private olive press owners himself. They, the authorities, he says, dare not open it up because they cannot. Do you want to know why? Somebody sold off half the machinery. It's simply money poured down the drain, that oil press. And as for the local contadino, well, he just covers his bottom with both hands for he knows he's going to be swindled. In Ralph Glasser's judgment, the people's resistance to the cooperative oil press is more subtle and deep-rooted.
Whereas dealing with a landlord, you are dealing with an individual with whom you had, for generations past, established a certain understanding, a certain kind of fiducia, in other words. With a cooperative, that is a completely impersonal organization, they had no conception of fiducia. There was no one to relate to. And so they said, mancanza di fiducia, nothing's going to happen. The result is the thing which has cost a very large amount of money stands there empty because they have no way of introducing fiducia into it.
But an even younger generation is poised to brush aside such practical attitudes. Exams over, Sister Gabriella and her flock celebrate in the new Bar Cam Trattoria, the first ever in San Giorgio, opened only a few weeks ago. Being there at all is an expression of a new liberty, for San Giorgio has never before countenanced this free presence of women in a bar, let alone girls. Sister Gabriella is young enough still to understand the girl's bubbling excitement as if it were her own. Indeed, her character contains a tincture of the same yearning for adventure, balanced, however, by her insight. But the girls will not listen to her words. They are impatient to fly. That wish is not new to their generation. What is new is that, unlike their mothers before them, they really can fly away.
Però non è peggio se noi abbandoniamo voi, perché ormai voi abbandonate i nostri paesi dove c'è una tradizione da rispettare, cioè dove ci sono, insomma, l'ambiente in cui sei vissuta, in cui trovi l'affetto, il calore della famiglia.
Io penso di andare a vivere in una città facendo nuove esperienze, nuove amicizie e magari di crearmi una propria personalità un poco diversa.
Ma vuoi andare in città per evitare i pettegolezzi?
Ma anche questo,
per la mentalità delle persone.
Anche questo, però per crearmi una, realizzarmi.
Perché lì non potreste realizzare.
No, perché non siete, si cambia nuove, mai la
siete
mentalità.
Siete nuove forze per la società.
Sì, ma la questione dei paesi rimangono sempre gli stessi. Non,
ma
se non
siete voi
mai.
Che dovete trasformare il paese, no?
Ma non è che possiamo soltanto noi. Cioè,
perché?
Soltanto noi. Ma ci deve essere anche una
Franca will go, and the others will go. But they will take away with them something of the steady heart of life, never to be recovered. If only one could make her see this, if only one could make her understand that one day, like Ibsen's Peer Gynt, to return to his village after wandering the world looking for his fulfillment, she will return to this place and look and say with him, my empire was here.
Night has come and soon the piazza will empty, leaving only a few of the elders to chew over eternal but ever-present problems. Vittorino, the contadino, a man wedded to the soil, has seen three of his sons go, to be vet, engineer, teacher. And now his youngest, Valerio, has made up his mind to go too. He has chosen his road. He will join the Marines.
Oh, io c'ho sto ragazzo, vabbè. Oh, c'ha 16 anni. Che succede? Un bel momento. Vuole la terra. Sta facendo la terra.
Poi?
E lei sta facendo la terra ancora. Che succede? Sta terra ha visto, ha paspato con le mani.
Come fanno in questo stato di vivere, diciamo così? Certo devono andare lì.
Non posso. Chi è che ha un pozzo di oliveto che lo può coltivare e poi dalla parte che realizza questi prodotti?
But what about Ralph Glasser's desire to find a compromise? One that would retain the good values of the past without the hardships which, as Vittorino well remembers, characterized the old order?
I giovani non conoscono, i vecchi hanno dimenticato. Chi eri ieri e chi sei oggi?
Alas for Vittorino Cerigoni and his generation. He was saying, in effect, we didn't realize what we were losing when we reached out for the fruits of progress as we understood them. I think he also dimly perceived a kind of compromise, which is the one I have in mind, and that is that we have to contrive a way to scale down our technological change and our economic planning to fit the local identity. And to fit the values as the local people see them. That would mean in practice that they could process their own produce instead of sending it out to be processed. They could supply many more of their own everyday needs than they do now. You remember the farmer when he was talking to Padre Vittorio, and he expressed it beautifully. He said, if you caress the earth, it gives you gold. Of course, he was referring to the agricultural setting, but you can extend the meaning and to interpret it as if he said, if you pursue a whole attitude to life that harmonizes completely with the total environment, including the human one, then you're on the right track.